नमस्ते, आदाब, सत श्री अकाल एंड हेलो। आई गौरव शर्मा वेलकम द व्यूअर्स टू टैग टीवी टू द लेटेस्ट एडिशन ऑफ इंडिया टॉक। अहेड ऑफ पीएम नरेंद्र मोदीज मीट विद लोकल कश्मीरी लीडर्स, अ लॉट ऑफ स्पेकुलेशंस आर हैपनिंग ऑन द प्रोबेबल चेंजेस इन द यूनियन टेरिटरी ऑफ जम्मू एंड कश्मीर। इट इज ऑल्सो बींग स्पेकुलेटेड दैट द स्टेटहुड माइट बी रिटेन्ड। अमिड ऑल दिस, द कंसर्न्स ऑफ द कश्मीरी हिंदू स्टिल रिमेन अनरिजॉल्व्ड। On ground, little seems to have changed since the abrogation of Article 370 and 35A for a common Kashmiri who was thrown out of the valley in 1990. To talk all about this, I have a very special guest on my show today. He is a Kashmiri Hindu, has worked in the Intelligence Bureau and served in many parts of India. He is a decorated retired officer from IB and he was awarded President's Indian Police Medal for his meritorious services. He has also received the highest award in IB, that is Kautilya. I have with me Shri Brijlal Sharma ji. I welcome you, Mr. Brijlal Sharma ji, and it is my absolute honor to have you on my panel today. So, firstly, I would like to ask you, what was the situation before the exodus of Kashmiri Hindus, which started in 1990? And like, what was the social situation? How were the two communities, the Kashmiri Hindus and Kashmiri Muslims, were living before the radicalization started in the valley?
Okay. See, to be very frank, Kashmir was rightly called the paradise on earth, at least till 80. It was a very peaceful state and people, both communities, lived amicably. Now, notwithstanding the existence of a sizable anti-India Muslim population all along the valley, vast majority of the community was open-minded, liberal, and unorthodox. No doubt about that. You may remember burqa, the veil which we call burqa wearing and face covering Muslim ladies, was not a common sight in the valley till the start of 21st century. Beef eating was not a preferred habit, meat habit, among urban educated Muslims. There were definitely some poor people in the villages, they did consume it, but that was primarily on the economic grounds. Otherwise, Muslims in urban areas did not consume it. And mind you, such were the pervading ethos that a concerned Muslim host would guide his Hindu guest away from beef eating area to a place which was perfect and kosher. Such was the ethos that existed there. Now, true, illiteracy and backwardness in some of the portion of the majority community might have caused some heartburning against the generally better placed financially and education Hindu community. But this is also a fact that there were no forcible conversion. There was no abduction of Hindu girls. There were no what's called major communal disturbances unless radicalization of this, unless political aspirations were sought to be realized by consolidating Muslims of the lines. That happened in late 80s. And it was then when Jamaat-e-Islami, a radical organization, took the they seized the opportunity in the 80s, late 80s. Otherwise, till then, there was nothing. Now, you may recall, even in 75, There was one Maqbool Bhatt. He was founder of Liberation Front organization, a terrorist organization. He infiltrated into Valley to garner support of Muslims. He failed. It was, you know, Jamaat-e-Islami, you call them, or radical elements, you call them. They started preparing their ground right from the 80s. They floated an organization called Islamic Study Circle, where educated Muslim, employed Muslim youth were radicalized. And you know, then that's what happened. This is my perception before this accident.
So, you know, this is something which we usually have not heard about. You know, of course, the general population is not to be blamed for this kind of exodus, and Kashmiri Hindus and Kashmiri Muslims have suffered equally in this kind of chaos which was created in 1990. So what exactly happened in January 1990? And do you think the global impact of what was happening around that area, say in Russia, because the USSR was also fighting at that time with the Chechen rebels, and the radicalization was on the rise in Afghanistan and of course in Pakistan. So does that also lead to the, you know, the situation what happened in January 1990 in Kashmir, with Kashmiri Hindus in particular?
See, setting free terrorists, hardcore terrorists, to secure release of Rubaiya Saeed, daughter of Mufti Muhammad Saeed, the then Union Home Minister, it lionized these terrorists. They started taking out victory processions. And such a situation was created that the whole state appeared to be surrendered, as if they had nothing. It appeared to be powerless and completely surrendered. Terrorists sent a very clear message to the people in the valley that they were in the command of things, and whatever dictates would be theirs, they will have to be accepted and carried out. Well, there were some sympathizers among the Muslims who first extended support to terrorists, primarily to seek secession from India. But Kashmiri Pandits had firm belief in what is called the Constitution of India, Democracy of India. They were not going to fall in line. But one thing what they did then, terrorists, was they started killing high-profile pundits, which included doctors, which included lawyers, which included engineers, paramedics. So just to create terror among Kashmiri pundits. And this also did not, you know, kill the instinct among Kashmiri Pandits. Then a routine thing happened. Threats were extended through mosques. It became a routine thing, asking Kashmiri Pandits either to surrender or get killed. Even so much so that they were asked that they should leave their women folk behind for them. So then, rest is history.
True. Like you said, yes, the rest is history. And we, you know, to a certain extent, we all know what exactly happened on 19th January 1990, when the Kashmiri Hindus were asked to leave the valley, you know, and the Kashmiri men were told to leave the valley and leave their women behind. And, you know, it was, I think, one in the history of Kashmir, it was possibly the last exodus of Kashmiri Hindus from the valley. Now, in August 2019, the present government of India has abrogated Article 370 and Article 35A, it stopped the statehood of Jammu and Kashmir. So how do you think are these steps going to help the cause of Kashmiri Hindus? Do you think is there any change?
Kashmiri Hindus, both, it is not even going to help Kashmiri Muslim. The politicians have made it a ploy. Otherwise, what has Article 370 and 35A to do with it? They have been exploiting this right from beginning. These two things, 370 and it is an inferiority complex in both. Hindus, Kashmiri Pandits feel probably it has been annexed with India. So this is conception among Kashmiri Pandits, and among Kashmiri Muslims they feel that we have further been alienated. Otherwise, these two things, but this is my opinion.
Okay. So it on ground, do you think there's no change in the situation after the abrogation of Article 370 and 35A?
Of course. Changes in this that, government of India can take certain steps. It has been doing it.
Mm-hmm. Now, we are now hearing some news from India that possibly, Prime Minister Modi is going to speak to the stakeholders in Kashmir, and there are also some resistance which is coming from the Kashmiri leaders. Also, the Jammu leaders are feeling alienated and saying that we have not been, given the opportunity to be a part of that organized meet, so that they can also put forward their own opinion. Now, keeping aside all these things, my primary concern would be to ask you a question. How do you see any reconciliation to be happening with Kashmiri Pandits? Do you think in the coming days, do you see any reconciliation, any truth and reconciliation happening with Kashmiri Hindus?
See, Kashmiri Hindus, reconciliation means to settle them in the state.
Yes.
Isn't it?
Yes.
I think Kashmiri Hindus will be prepared to get settled in the state only when the last gun of the terrorists is silenced. There are no safe zones and unsafe zones. Both the communities definitely have to live together as they used to live. I am personally of the opinion that I would come. When such a thing would happen, it will take time. Government of India has to tread a very thorny path. It cannot please everybody, of course. You have to go for errors and trials. These are things that government of India rightly is taking up certain measures with dexterity and strong measures. So let us hope what will happen.
Mm-hmm. So my last question to you would be regarding the role of the civil society. What do you think the civil society can do in doing this reconciliation and helping Kashmiri Hindus settle back in the valley once again? What could be the action plan of civil society, not only of organizations belonging to Kashmiri Hindus, but the general public as such in India and overseas?
Well, I think something will have to be done. Both the communities will have to fight. You cannot know. If you do one thing in favor of a Kashmiri Pandit, then Muslims will be annoyed. If you do something in favor of a Kashmiri Muslim, then Hindus will be annoyed. Both the communities have to live together And for that, conducive atmosphere has to be created. Muslims have to give this inferiority complex that it was Article 370 that had given us everything. In fact, I have spoken to a lot of friends among Muslims who are of the opinion that once 370 is gone, development has started taking place. Earlier, the governments in the state were not answerable. So abrogation of Article 370, which was basically a very temporary thing, had to go today or tomorrow. If it has gone and development is taking place, basically our communities have to live together. They have lived together in the past, and civil society has a major role. They have to be cordial.
Right. That absolutely. Absolutely right. I think the need of the hour is to speak more about this topic and bring community leaders forward, and they must have a dialogue between themselves as to what has to be done going forward. Whatever has happened, and it is very unfortunate that it happened. And no words can ever be enough to explain the plight of what happened with the Kashmiri Hindus. In the end, I would like to ask you if you have any further remarks to add in this conversation. Anything which you think we have missed in this conversation, I would request you to add any of those.
To be very honest, now this government is doing something positive, definitely. Now, if you think of past 70s, elections were never ever held honestly and sincerely in the state of JNK. First major election which was really held honestly was under Morarji Desai. Before that, even it was on record that somebody would fill the form and it would be rejected by a deputy commissioner and see that this congressman was elected. Because then Sheikh Mohammed Abdullah was not taking part. But after 75, when he came, there was a dialogue between Partha Sarathy and Vaig and Partha Sarathy. So they joined the mainstream, Sheikh Mohammed Abdullah. Within 6 months, the Congress elements in Valley, they started agitating against the government, Sheikh Mohammed Abdullah's government, National Congress government. And you know, what happened in last years in 80s, there are, when this, what's called Farooq Abdullah, he was dethroned, this governor's rule was imposed. Then again, this Farooq Abdullah was compelled by Rajiv Gandhi to have an alliance with Congress. This was not liked by the local people, and that was the birth of MUF, that is called Muslim United Front. Otherwise, Kashmiri Muslim as such was very much secular. You know, insecurity, we have created insecurity. But then, whether it was headed by Indira Gandhi or it was headed later by Rajiv Gandhi, they did create. No elections were really held as in other parts of India were held. So they have been driven back and back. That has been also a reason that we cannot ignore. You have to bring this thing also that whole of Muslim community felt annoyed when Farooq Abdullah joined hands with Rajiv Gandhi in the elections. They felt he was with him. He had been dethroned by them. And again he went to them. That means we have no say. It is only dead together. Now this government is trying to establish some political process. Let us see. what can be yielded.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think what I just want to add here is that the international media also plays a significant role in in enhancing and smoothening the process of political development and the socio-economic change which is planned in the valley. And I sincerely hope that in the coming years, because I am sure this is not going to end in months, you know, it's a legacy of decades, and it cannot happen in a span of weeks. So I sincerely hope that in the coming years and the successive governments in India take a positive stance in improving the situation both for Kashmiri Hindus and Kashmiri Muslims, because it's the general population which gets impacted the most when things like these happen.
Gaurav, I'll tell you, there is not a single village in Kashmir where there does not exist a shrine which was frequented both by Hindus and Muslims. This cannot be ignored. And radical elements within the community, majority community, they started targeting this shrine. There were Muslim peers. You will not believe there is a place in Anantnag where from high hill, the shrine of Rishi Mohr, that Rishi was a vegetarian. And in 1 year, we observe 5 days of the Rishi, not Hindus, all the Muslims in the district, they don't consume mutton during those days. And nobody visits the shrine after taking mutton. This has been our culture. You have both Hindus and Muslims have to live together in that. That is for certain. Thinking that a Hindu should live at place A, which that will be safe zone, and he cannot live at place B, that will be unsafe zone, there are no such zones. That has been my, both the communities have to live. And I am hopeful time would come, we may or may not be alive, that they will reconcile. Both communities will live together again. Because it is in their DNA.
Right. Very right. So on that note, I would like to thank you for again being part of my show. And it was a real honor to have you on the panel. I wish you a very healthy life. And we hope that someday Kashmiri Hindus get back to their homes once again. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
So you were hearing Mr. Brij Lal Sharma ji on the present situation of Kashmiri Hindus in Kashmir. I hope that you liked the video. And please like, subscribe, and comment on our videos. And thank you so much for watching. Stay safe. Stay blessed.